This is the podcast for Multi-Faith Matters. I'm the host, John Moorhead. Thanks to everyone for listening and for watching. And if you would help us out by clicking like and subscribing and giving us a great rating on whatever platform you happen to be partaking of this. And of course, we need your support. If you'd like to look at our patrons page to help us keep this going. Enough of the commercial announcement. I'm privileged today to have as my guest, and I'm hoping I'm pronouncing this correctly. If I'm not, please correct me. Massimo Introvigna. Is that correct?
Yes.
I got it. Very good. Thank you so much. I'm going to go ahead and read a bio that I found off of one of the websites that you're involved with. Massimo is an Italian sociologist of religions. He is the founder and managing director of the Center for Studies on New Religions, an international network of scholars who study new religious movements. Introvigna is the author of some 70 books and more than 100 articles in the field of sociology of religion. He was the main author of the Encyclopedia of Religions in Italy. He is a member of the editorial board for the Interdisciplinary Journal of Research on Religion and the executive board of University of California Press's Nova Religio. From January 5th to December 31st, 2011, he served as the representative on combating racism, xenophobia, and discrimination, with a special focus on discrimination against Christians and members of other religions of the Organizations for Security and Cooperation in Europe. From 2012 to 2015, he served as chairperson of the Observatory of Religious Liberty, instituted by the Italian Ministry of Foreign Affairs, in order to monitor the problems of religious liberty on a worldwide scale. Massimo, welcome to the Multi-Faith Matters podcast.
Good evening or good morning, whatever it is.
Well, I'm so happy to have you here. I've been a follower of your work and some of your colleagues like Gordon Melton and what you're doing at Cessna for many years. So I appreciate you taking the time. Today, we're going to be talking about the Western esoteric tradition. And as I mentioned, when you and I chatted briefly before we started recording the podcast, this is something that I think there's a lot of misunderstanding and stereotypes, particularly amongst American Christians and evangelicals. So let's begin with the use of terminology. How is Western esotericism defined, and how does that term relate to others like the term the occult or metaphysics?
Yeah, right now there is a very important and sometimes heated discussion in the academia whether esotericism is just a Western concept or if we can find something like esotericism also in Asia or Africa. And that discussion is still going on, but first we should establish what is esotericism. And that's something one particular academic who unfortunately died 2 months ago, Antoine Fèvre from the Sorbonne University in Paris, devoted his entire life to. And there is no agreement in the definition of esotericism, but I believe from the point of view of Christian, and I happen to be an active Christian myself, it is important to understand that there are two different and not entirely compatible definitions. For one definition, and that was Fèvre's preferred definition, esotericism is just a methodology. It's a way of looking at a religious tradition trying to find not so much the logical or philosophical part of this tradition, but the mystical or symbolic parts, which are normally grasped only through imagination or sometimes emotion or special experiences rather than by reasons alone. That definition of esotericism as a methodology explains why the chair of the Sorbonne University in Paris created for Antoine Fèvre was called esoterical and mystical currents in the West. So it's put together esotericism and mysticism, even if they are not exactly one and the same. As opposite to this, there is another definition of esotericism, and it's a definition sometimes connected with the so-called traditionalist school, and a definition Fevre did not agree with, nor do I, for what matters. And this definition is esotericism is a system of doctrines. And it's a sort of the result of an operation. You try to take away from all the main religious traditions what is more superficial and not essential. And when you have eliminated all this, supposedly, and again, I don't believe it, supposedly you would reach what the traditionalist authors such as René Guénon or Fridtjof Schwann would call the transcendental core, which supposedly again, and again I don't believe it, will be one and the same in all religions. So this essential or transcendental or mysterious or metaphysical core of Christianity, once we get rid of all the historical superstructure of Christianity, will be recognizable as one and the same as the essential core of Islam, the essential core of Buddhism, of Hinduism, of Judaism, and all the great or legitimate religious traditions. So as you see, these two definitions are very much different, because it's clear that Orthodox Christian should stay away from esotericism, because in the second sense, esotericism becomes either the apology for relativism, all religions are the same, are equally true, but that means they are equally false, or it becomes a competing religion. And that's something the apostles are already seen when they were confronted with Simon Magus or early Gnosticism. Because in this case, the mysteriosity or the search for common mysteries in our religion just resulted in establishing another religion. And you cannot be a Christian and a member of another religion at the same time. On the other hand, if esotericism is seen as a methodology, just a way of looking for the more mystical, sometimes hidden, not because somebody wants to hit them, but because they are difficult, objectively difficult to understand. In this case, there have been quite a few authors who have promoted the Christian esotericism, even if, of course, when you separate yourself from the more rational and objective points of theology, you can verge on a dangerous trend. But anyway, it's the methodology is something different. Now, the occult, again, occult is a comparatively recent word. There is not the word occultism. Of course, the occult is what is hidden. That dates back to Roman times. But occultism only appears at the end of the 19th century. And it is the idea that from esotericism you can derive some practical benefits through practical techniques. And so these techniques can be putting yourself in touch with the stars or new forms of astrology. Of course, astrology is a very old thing, or getting in touch with the spirits, so spiritualism and other ways of contacting either the spirits of the deceased or other spirits supposedly existing in our universe, or using your body through a variety of need, some of them sexual, to get some alchemical results of transmuting yourself into a higher being with supposed superpowers, etc. So the esotericism is theoretical, even for those who believe it's a system and it's not just a methodology, while occultism is practical.
That question of definition is very helpful, and thank you for helping unpack all of that. Can you summarize? I know this is just huge, but can you hit some key points and perhaps summarize some of the history and the intellectual thought that has gone, that makes up Western esotericism?
Yeah, Western, again, the word esotericism only appeared at the end of the 18th or 19th century. But very often the thing precedes the word. I mean, there were what today we would call esoteric systems and methods well before the word esotericism appeared. So basically, even we can find, of course, esoteric approaches in Greek and Roman culture, the systematic exploration of this mysterious or hidden side of religion started really in Hellenistic time. So roughly around the time of Jesus Christ, when there was a lot of syncretism and comparative exploration of religions, Egyptian, Greek, Roman, and people started really to be interested in these mysteries. And some books started circulated called Hermetica, which were attributed to Hermes Trismegistus, which was actually a divine figure. But of course, Hermes Trismegistus was not the real author of these books. We don't know actually who the authors were, but were probably a group of people interested in these ideas we would today call esoterica. In the Middle Ages, the church was not very favorable to this speculation, and some philosophers we can call esoteric, such as Michael Scotus, found themselves in trouble, but there was a huge revival of esoteric ideas with the Renaissance. And one of the things that prompted this revival was that the Jews had always been interested in an esoteric approach called the Kabbalah. And in the 16th century, there were the first European scholars, Christian scholars, who were able to translate and understand the Kabbalah, which is a very difficult system, and they created what is called the Christian Kabbalah, so a Christianized version of the Jewish Kabbalah. What happened next is that the Protestants were very much against the esoteric approach. They regarded it as evidence that the Catholic Church has never really cut the umbilical tie with the Roman and Greek paganism. So there was an anti-esoteric approach in Protestant countries, even if some of the founder of modern esotericism, such as Jacob Boehme, he lived in the 17th century in Protestant countries. In the 18th century, there was a second wave of criticism of esotericism coming not so much from Christianity, but from the rationalism of the Enlightenment. But again, in some of the institutions which supposedly promoted the Enlightenment, including Freemasonry, there were quite a few people who were interested in esotericism and even in the practical version of occultism. Comes the 19th century, there is a great, after the criticism and even the persecution of esotericists by the French Revolution, there is a great revival, which is, however, accompanied by a new criticism coming from Marxism, for which the esotericism is part of the opiate of the people, and it's a waste of time. Marx was very concerned with esotericism because some of the esoteric organizations were more or less socialist, but they practiced forms of non-Marxist socialism. So there was a competition, and he regarded the esoteric socialism, which is now very much studied, more or less as a waste of time. And I would say that esotericism continues to be a form of rejected knowledge because rationalism dominated the academia until, I would say, in the 1960s, as one of the main products of the 60s, even in the academia, there was a serious study of esotericism with chairs of esoteric history being established at the Sorbonne, and notably because a whole institute flourished there and still a leading role in this field at the University of Amsterdam in the Netherlands. And that eventually led to the establishment of two separate organizations, which include each several hundred scholars and sometimes overlaps. In the United States, the Association for the Study of Esotericism, ASE, and in Europe, the ESSWE, the European Society for the Study of Western Esotericism. So now I would say that as opposite to, I would say, the 1960s, there is a recognizable academic community of people studying esotericism in the academia. There are specialized journals, publishing house, etc. And there is, of course, a popular interest in esotericism. Of course, the New Age was a sort of folk esotericism, which perhaps the academic didn't particularly like. They would prefer to study Jacob Boehme or Pico della Mirandola, but on the other hand, the New Age put the millions in touch with esoteric ideas. So for me, I'm a sociologist more than an historian. The New Age is a phenomenon that cannot be ignored because perhaps it was never very deep in its theories, but it has an enormous social impact that perhaps more deep or serious esoteric investigations never had.
Is there any reliable way to come up with estimates as to how many people might be practicing esotericism?
Well, esotericism is not an organized religion, so you can know how many Jehovah's Witnesses there are around, roughly, because you don't know if some who have been baptized are still active, etc., but statistics are more or less available. But you cannot know how many are interested in esotericism. The esoteric groups, organized groups, tend to be comparatively small. I mean, the largest was probably the Theosophical Society, but it's now reduced to less than 20,000 people. But people who read the books about esoterica, go to esoteric bookstores, may follow podcasts about esoteric ideas. These are probably in the world some millions. And when, like if you ask how many people are involved in new religious movements, the problem is where you put the boundaries. You mentioned Gordon Melton. One of Gordon Melton's theories, which he has presented in several books, is that Scientology is not a sort of evil cult, and it's not exactly a religion, but it's a sort of modern version of mass esotericism. That's Gordon Melton's idea. We can discuss it. But of course, if you include phenomena like Scientology in the field of Western esotericism, then your numbers can go up.
Since you mentioned Scientology, what are some of the major expressions that folks might be aware of, and those that maybe they aren't aware of and need to be, that would represent the Western esoteric tradition?
Well, until before the New Age, when everything became very fragmented, particularly in the U.S., the most important tradition was the Rosicrucian tradition, which it's, I would say, quintessentially an esoteric tradition. And there were different competing groups, but a large group, even if many people were sort of mail order devotees, they paid a sum and they received material to study at home. They didn't particularly like to gather, even if some did, was the AMORC, the Antique and Mystical Order of the Rosy Cross. If you go to San Jose in California, they have a huge quasi-Egyptian temple, which serves as their world headquarters. But there were other Rosicrucian organizations, like the Rosicrucian Fellowship, which is also headquartered in California, founded by a Danish esotericist, Max Heindel, and other minor or smaller organizations. I would say that the Theosophical Society is an esoteric organization, even if they would say that they have two circles. One just organizes lectures, mostly about Buddhism or Hinduism, and then they have the esoteric circle, but not all members are members of the esoteric circles. And one large schism of the Theosophical Society is the Anthroposophical Society, founded in Germany by Rudolf Steiner. And Steiner separated himself from the Theosophical Society because he regarded himself as a Christian, and he disagreed with the negative evaluation of Christianity by some of the Theosophical leaders who preferred Hinduism or Buddhism, even if Steiner's Christianity would probably be regarded as not orthodox by many Christians. But again, anthroposophy is made of concentric circles. Many who attend some activities of anthroposophy, like the Waldorf schools or the Camp Hill communities for the disabled, which I believe do a very good job in assisting the disabled, but not all of them are really committed to the spiritual or esoteric principle of anthroposophy. For instance, in the Camp Hill communities, say there is an inner circle that you are free to join or not to join, and those who join the inner or spiritual circle, these are those who are really committed to the esoteric ideas of Steiner. But you can work for a Camp Hill community and assist the disabled and not be a member of the inner circle. I would say in the US, these are the strongest traditions. In Europe, there will be the Martinist tradition, which follows the teaching of two unrelated esoteric masters of the end of the 18 and beginning of the 19th century with similar names but not related, Martinez de Pasquali and Saint-Martin. Martinism is a strong tradition in some European countries, but a small or tiny organization in the United States. And then, of course, we should open a discussion on Freemasonry, because Freemasonry is a broad category. And both in Europe and the United States, most Masonic lodges have largely abandoned the esoteric teachings and activities of the 18th or early 19th centuries. They are more like social clubs with sort of either liberal Christian or liberal but not Christian, but mostly European ideology. However, there are forms of Freemasonry which still cultivate esoteric traditions which were prevalent in the early 18th century Freemasonry. They may be called Egyptian Freemasonry. They may be called in different ways, but a strong commitment to the esoteric research is not today found in the majority of the Masonic lodges, although it is found in some of them.
We got a hint of this when you were going through the definitions of terms, and I know there's great diversity here, but what would be some common practices and ideas that would run through esotericism?
Well, most esoteric masters, they would teach a philosophy rather than practices, but of course some will teach practices as well. For instance, in the traditionalist school, there were never many practices, except that some of the traditionalist leaders, they say all religions are equal, but there is one which is more equal than the other, and ended up converted to Islam. So Islam, not in the shape of, I would say, political Islam or missionary Islam, but in the shape of Sufism. Sufism is, one can say, is the esoteric tradition within Islam, and it has certain practices, certain way of chanting, which are peculiar to Sufism. So in the traditional school, some will teach zikr, but zikr is a way of chanting which comes from Sufism. Now, those who have occult practices, including, for example, many Rosicrucian schools, after they teach you the theory, they will teach you some practices. And these practices start with visualization, when you visualize certain energies and supposedly attract these energies within your field. There can be some form of chanting of ritual formulas, and when you progress in the way, there can be evocation of spirits, which in many traditions are not spirits of the deceased. That's the spiritualist tradition, which still exists in the United States. You can go to places like Lilydale, mm-hmm. upstate New York. It's still a camp with all. If you want to become a resident of Lilydale, which I visited several times, you should prove you are a spiritualist medium. Otherwise, you cannot buy or rent a home. So people go there on weekend, and there are all these mediums who offer their services, put you in touch with your just deceased uncle or husband or son. But Lily Dale is more than this, because it has been in existence since the 19th century, so we have a wonderful archive of material about the history of spiritualism in United States. And like other people before COVID, unfortunately, they had decided to reach out to the academic community and organize academic conference. I have attended a couple of them, but then COVID came and this experiment was interrupted. As I say, most other groups, the spirits to be contacted are more spirits which are neither angels nor demons and supposedly exist in our universe, and some more Christianized will say when St. Paul gives all these lists, thrones and dominations, it alludes to the idea of many spirits which can enter into a conversation with us. And not all Rosicrucian groups, and not all esoteric groups, but groups who have esoteric practices, very often would have practices centered on sexuality, because there can be a sort of magical use of sexuality. To generate not children but inner children, which would survive your death and evolve in a special way in the astral world or in the spiritual world. Now, here there are a lot of misunderstandings because when we talk about sexual magic is not a politically correct word. The practitioners don't want scholars to use it. They want to use sacred eroticism. But sacred eroticism basically goes in two ways. And these two ways have both existed in Hindu Buddhist Jain Tantrism, which is really the matrix. That's a transversal or ecumenical religious movement in India around the year 1000, well, before and after. And it's a movement which reacted against what was perceived as the excessive spiritualization of this religion, which proposed sort of escaping from the material reality. And so tantrists say, let's try the other ways to use the material reality to achieve enlightenment. Now, material reality was not only sexuality, it was, for instance, the food or the visual arts. So tantrism produced a very significant artistic movement, but it was also sexuality. But already in tantrism, and those who imported into Western esotericism these techniques, normally found them in India, already in tantrism there were two very different schools. One schools were sort of orgiastic, so let's liberate the sexuality, and supposedly all this energy can be channeled to some effect. But that was so-called the left-hand path, which was never the majority. It's not the oldest and it's not the largest in India. And in the West, it's mostly connected with the Aleister Crowley, who was a British magus who spent significant time in India and really learned the techniques there. Interestingly, for Christians, he was reacting against Christianity because of the strict education he had received in the Plymouth Brethren. His father was a leader in this Christian sect. So Crowley is at the origin of a current called Thelema, which comes from Rabelais, the abbey of Telemach, was a satiric early modern French novel. And Rabelais had put represented an abbey whose motto was "Do what you will," and so Crowley also is "Do what you will," which is not really just "don't care," because will is a magical force. So you should have this wild sexual experience, but then you should have cultivated your will to direct all this energy to a magical purpose. But as I say, that's a minority tradition. The largest tantric or neo-tantric tradition practices something else, practices sexuality without ejaculation. So men should stop just 1 minute before the conclusion of the sexual act, because the tantric idea, which is widespread in some Western esoteric currents as well, but they take it from the Indian Tantra, is that in this case, the sexual energy, rather than going outside, it flows inward. And according to the Hindu, basically, physiology, we have several energy centers called chakras, and it goes up from the lower chakras to the upper chakras and gives some wonderful results, both in enhancing our consciousness and in allowing the formation of a body of light, which is a sort of double, which will again survive us when we die. And today there are some very large organizations with this sort of teachings, but not so much in the United States. It's more like in Latin America and in Europe, particularly in Eastern Europe, Romania, Bulgaria. In the United States, these teachings are not widespread, and you can go to a lot of Tantra seminars for the weekend, but these are mostly offered by masters who will not call themselves esoteric, but rather Hindu or perhaps Taoist, masters from China or Thailand. So the esoteric part is less emphasized, it's more the Eastern part. But the tantrism mediated by some esoteric masters still inspires a number of esoteric movements, but not so much in the United States.
Now, you mentioned earlier that the New Age movement is something of a folk expression of esotericism, and that some scholars may not have been too thrilled to study that aspect of it. But it seems to me that sometimes these popular or folk expressions of any religious tradition can tell us something significant about what's going on in the culture and why these things are appealing. How has esotericism impacted popular culture, and what might that tell us about why this continues to be serve an important function in people's lives?
Perhaps I should premise this with the fact that now we know that esotericism has impacted the high culture too. One of the most popular field of research in the academia now is the impact of esotericism on modern art. And there have been huge exhibitions. One of the first was like 15 or 20 years ago in Los Angeles, on the impact of esotericism on modern art. If we look at abstract art, Kandinsky went to the lectures of Rudolf Steiner, and even before, he wrote it in so many words that he never was a member of Theosophical Society, but many of his ideas about the art came from his exploration of Theosophical ideas. Mondrian was as important perhaps as Kandinsky for the foundation of contemporary abstract art was a card-carrying member and very active in the Theosophical Society. If we move to Canada, Lauren Harris, who is the founder of Canadian Modern Art, was a member of Theosophical Society. Even he had a radio show to propagate the ideas of the Theosophical Society. In Europe, of course, the Salon de la Rose Croix, which were organized by one of the Rosicrucian organizations, were extremely important for European art in the 19th century. But even in the 20th century, there are enormous points of contact between modern art and the esoteric. I believe this happened because there was a sort of divorce, which was never total, but was significant, of the arts from Christianity. So the artistic community was one of those communities which lost contact after the Enlightenment with the Christian churches. And most of the artists and institutions preparing the artists were quite anti-Christian. But I believe that it's very difficult to produce artists who are totally non-spiritual. Your art becomes very boring, like the socialist realism in the Soviet Union. And so they looked for alternative spiritualities. And even when it was fashionable to declare yourself as Marxist, that was not the total story. For instance, Diego Rivera and Frida Kahlo are so popular now, the Mexican artists. They were staunch Marxists, but Rivera was also the founder of the lodge in Mexico City of the ancient mystical order of the Rosy Cross. And Frida Kahlo always says she was an atheist, but then she has a series of drawings and paintings called Karma, which are really about the reincarnation. So you see, these Marxists were not totally Marxist, but surely they were not Christian. So that's for sure. So there is an impact of esotericism, and we can discuss novels, for instance, how extremely popular novels have been impacted by esotericism. One of the interesting book of this year is about Rider Haggard, who was an extremely part of the Minds of King Solomon. You know, many movies were done. And he was a popular Victorian novelist, and he was very much into the esoteric ideas, although at the same time he was also curious of debates about Christianity. Was a sort of leftist Christians interested in radical biblical criticism. So, and we can of course continue. Conan Doyle, the creator of Sherlock Holmes, was very much involved in spiritualism, so was Victor Hugo in France, and so on and so on. Pamela Travers, the creator of Mary Poppins, for instance, was a follower of the Armenian esoteric master George Gurdjieff. So we can go to the music, of course. Many musicians were like Stockhausen, were interested in esoteric ideas. So in short, and not to go into too many details, what happened is the intellectual elite after the Enlightenment largely, as I say, never totally, because there were always Christian musicians, Christian painters, Christian novelists, but largely divorced from Christianity. And since to be creative, you have always something spiritual, they were looking for alternative spiritualities. Now, this is also true for popular culture, because there is a popular culture appealing to the masses who have abandoned Christianity or have remained Christians in name only. So before something called the New Age emerged at the end of the 60s, there were already large masses interested in spiritualism or in astrology, which are not exactly Christian ideas. And the New Age was initially a label which put together all these trends and created not a movement, because the New Age was never a movement, but a network through festivals, through fairs, through bookstores, which were very important. Then the New Age went into some decline because it had an element of fashion, and so the fashions normally don't last forever. And so to call yourself a New Ager today, but I say perhaps in the 21st century, is less popular than it was in the 80s or in the 90s. Somebody will speak of a next age who says the new age, and other people will use other labels. However, the idea of networking in alternative spiritualities is still very popular, both with common people and with the elites. If you look at the phenomenon like the Burning Man Festival, that's attended by Bill Gates, and it's attended by old hippies with their backpacks. So you see that there is still this idea of networking and putting together different alternative spiritualities in sort of potpourri, where you don't really have a sense of belonging, but in another way you do, because you don't belong to a religion, you don't belong to a movement, but you belong to a network. And you know, there are times like these festivals or places like Findhorn, which still exists, of course, in Scotland, or for the more cultivated Esalen, which also still exists in Big Sur, where you can go and find a number of activities.
That's all very helpful. I think folks can particularly connect with how they might see it in pop culture. Let's talk a little bit about how Christians tend to view it. And that's kind of what we began with in terms of the purpose here. In a lot of Christian quarters, there is fear of the occult, and it's frequently associated with spiritual evil and with Satan and Satanism and this kind of a thing. When did these kinds of associations really come together? And why do you think there has been this continuous fear of the occult?
Yeah, the association is very old, because of course magicians have been associated with Satan since the fathers of the church. So the idea that if magicians produce effects, since cannot be science, and it cannot be God, because their doctrines are not good, the only remaining explanation is the devil. So that idea is of course very old. It's an old idea which has had historical consequences. Well, there is a lot to say about it. I do believe personally in the existence of the devil. So I will not rule out that some phenomena may be provoked by the devil. I always recommended a method of coming to the devil to explain phenomena as the very last explanation, because for most of these phenomena, you don't need the devil. They may have natural causes, they may have psychological causes, and the parapsychology is a slippery science, but it's science with some academic chairs nonetheless, and it doesn't posit the operation necessarily of spirits, but perhaps of forces we don't totally understand yet. As I say, it's a slippery area. And parapsychologists may be serious people. You have had a few in the United States, or can be charlatans or pseudos. So it's a difficult area. So I would say that it is possible. And if we read the Bible, there are, of course, examples of this, that some so-called magical phenomena are caused by the devil. But I would say to come to this only after having exhausted all the other possible lines of investigation and explanation. I remember a document by the Catholic Church of some years ago about other religions, where it was said that you should carefully distinguish what you can recognize as the influence of the devil and the fact that people consciously know that they are submitting themselves to the influence of the devil. These are two totally different things. And I believe most people who participate in esoteric activities, they don't want to enter into any relationship with the devil. And many people believe that esotericism can lead to things like universal brotherhood or interreligious dialogue. For instance, most theosophists join the Theosophical Society because it promises this brotherhood and reconciliation between all religions. Now, a Christian can say they are misguided, because rather than accepting the truth of Christianity, we want to find something else, as you pose the common truth beyond all religions. But on the other hand, I believe we should recognize that these people are often in good faith, and they even do good deeds in the sense of doing charitable or benevolent activities. As for those who put into practice some occult techniques like visualization, astrology, or even sexual practices, again, one mistake Christians sometimes make who are not familiar with this milieu, it's say these people are just dilettanti or people who want to have fun. But we should reflect on the fact that to have fun with sexuality, you don't need esoteric ideas these days. And so we should, again, credit these people with the fact that they really believe they are into a research for experiences of enlightenment. And again, it's a research from a Christian point of view, one may say misguided, or one can find the same or better experience in Christian meditation or Christian mysticism. But again, there is no reason to believe that most of these practitioners are in bad faith. I would say most of these practitioners really believe they can seek enlightenment or better states of conscience through these practices. So I will be careful in judging, while I fully agree when Christian pastors warn their people not to enter into these kinds of experiments, because these kinds of experiments are rarely ideologically compatible with an orthodox form of Christianity. So I agree with the pastors, but at the same time, I believe that confronted with people in most of these paths or organizations, we should not immediately assume they are evil people or they are in bad faith. They are searching for something outside of Christianity. And that leads me to another idea. That sometimes as Christians we should do some soul searching, because there are many reasons why people look outside of Christianity. There are historical reasons dating back at least to the Enlightenment and the criticism of Christianity by mainstream culture starting in the 18th century. Of this we are surely not responsible, but sometimes we are responsible in a way that if people, and including young people, they find Christianity boring or too intellectual or too social sometimes, too much focused on social justice, not that social justice is not important, of course, but less focused in inner exciting inner experience or spiritual experience. If people don't find in Christianity these things and will go seek them in groups mixing Eastern and Western spirituality, or will go seek them in the Western esoteric traditions or in the Rosicrucians or whatever not, I believe sometimes we may also ask ourselves whether we offer the experiences these people are looking for. And I believe within Christianity, of course, there is a mystical tradition, and there are traditions which can speak to people who end up finding Christianity boring, but many of these people, they don't know, of course, they don't know anything more than their local pastor or priest, and they may find their local community somewhat not inspiring enough.
As we close here, can you recommend maybe a few books and resources that folks can seek out who want to learn more about esotericism?
Yeah, I can recommend some authors, and one is a Dutch professor called Wouter Hanegraaff, H-A-N-E-G-R-A-A-F-F. And if you look at Hanegraaff on Amazon, you can find some very small books which are introductory and suitable for the non-professional, and some huge books which are more suitable for the college students or academics. So Hanegraaff is surely a valuable guide, and you can find also some of the books by Antoine Favre, F-A-I-V-R-E, have been translated into English. So these are the two, I would say, main names as academics studying the New Age. And you mentioned Gordon Melton. So if you want to check out a specific group, Gordon Melton publishes periodically encyclopedias, including the Encyclopedia of American Religion, which I believe is found in many libraries in the United States, an expensive book, but it's a very useful resource where you can check out many different groups. Many years ago, Melton published a Dictionary of the New Age too. I don't know if it's still available, and that includes entries on many currents and groups which are part of esotericism and eventually became part of the New Age too.
Well, Dr. Intravenia, I appreciate you taking the time and coming and sharing your vast expertise with my listening and viewing audience today.
Thank you.
It's been a pleasure.